To my dear brothers and sisters, it's always nice to be back in Toronto. Well, nice to be back in Canada, back in Toronto, and back in this masjid. It's always a pleasure. This is such a blessed part of the world. It's such an island, Canada in general, and Toronto and this masjid is such an island of sanity and peace and welfare for humanity in general and for Muslims in particular. Take it from me. Different parts of the world are going crazy. I was in the States yesterday giving some lectures, and it's things sometimes go out of control there for Muslims. And I was in Europe last month. Things are also quite problematic. So it's from the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be in this island, very big island that we call Canada. Ramadan is approaching, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless our Ramadan. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala take us to Ramadan. That was from the dua of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allahumma balighna Ramadan. Take us towards Ramadan. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us through Ramadan to be better people. It's very difficult to change. It's very difficult to come closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But it's very easy when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes it easy and opens the doors and opens the hearts for us to become closer to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is the gift of Ramadan. Maqasid, qasada, yaqsid has to do with an objective or an end or a goal. It has to do with the question of why. Like, why Ramadan? Are we allowed to ask why in Islam? Of course. In fact, we don't ask why enough. How do you know that why is permissible and why is allowed and why is important? I know that from the Quran. Because the Quran talks about so many things that we should do and we should not do, and so many things that happen in history, and so many things that will happen in the future. And for everything that the Quran talks about, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us why, gives us an objective, an end, the end of the road, why we are doing that. And especially in Ramadan, if we reflect upon the verses in the Quran that deal with Ramadan directly, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كتب عليكم الصيام كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم لعلكم تتقون. All you who believe, fasting is ordained, is prescribed to you as it was prescribed for those who were before you, so that you achieve taqwa. The Arabic word is taqwa, لعلكم, so that you might, so that perhaps you achieve taqwa. And taqwa is translated in different ways. Sometimes so that you fear Allah, some translations, and sometimes so that you gain consciousness of Allah, consciousness, taqwa. Taqa, yattaqi, is to put something between you and something else, is to protect yourself. To protect yourself from Allah's punishment, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And to protect yourself from an-nar, fattaqu an-nar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran is saying, fear the hellfire, protect yourself. And to protect yourself is a very basic word in the English language. See, the English language, without bias, wallahi, but knowing both languages very well, the English language is poor when it comes to the Islamic terminology. Taqwa, it's very difficult to translate that. It's a mixture of fear, but not only fear, fear and hope, and consciousness and action. And it is a mixture of things that brings you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. Lam, this lam in Arabic, we call it lam al-sababiyya, the lam of the reason. Why? Why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us fast in Ramadan so that we achieve taqwa. This taqwa is making you a better person. So when you fast for 30 days, the Prophet ﷺ explained that, and the Sunnah is the bayan of the Quran. The Sunnah is the illustration of the Quran. The Quran gives us everything in general terms, and the Sunnah explains. The Prophet ﷺ said, قَدْ أَضَلَّكُمْ شَهْرٌ عَظِيمٌ مُبَارَكٌ. Now a great month is approaching. شَهْرٌ فِيهِ لَيْلَةٌ خَيْرٌ مِنْ أَلْفِ شَهْرٍ. There is a night in that month that is better than 1,000 months. The Prophet said, شَهْرٌ جَعَلَ اللَّهُ صِيَامَ نَهَارِهِ فَرِيضَةً وَقِيَامَ لَيْلِهِ تَطَوَّعًا. Allah made fasting during the day an obligation, and He made praying at night a recommendation. وَهُوَ شَهْرُ الصَّبْرِ. It is the month of patience. وَشَهْرُ الْمُوَاسَاةِ. And it is the month of benevolence. وَشَهْرٌ يُزَادُ فِيهِ رِزْقُ الْمُؤْمِنِ. And it's a month where the providence of the believer increases. And so forth. All of this is included in the taqwa. To become more conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To become a better person. لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. أَيَّامًا مَعْدُودَاتٍ. A few days. فَمَنْ كَانَ مِنْكُمْ مَرِيضًا أَوْ عَلَى سَفَرٍ فَعِدَّةٌ مِنْ أَيَّامٍ أُخَرٍ. Those of you who are sick or on travel, then they can compensate with a number of other days, as many days as they are sick or on travel. وَعَلَى الَّذِينَ يُطِيقُونَهُ فِدْيَةٌ طَعَامُ مِسْكِينٍ. And those who cannot afford, those who are not up to fasting it, يُطِيقُونَهُ, also one of those Arabic words, those who cannot fulfill the obligation, they can fast a number of other days. وَعَلَى الَّذِينَ they can give fidya, they can give charity or give food to people. فِدْيَةٌ طَعَامُ مِسْكِينٍ. Give food to somebody who is needy. That compensates for fasting of a day. وَأَنْ تَصُومُ فَمَنْ تَطَوَعَ خَيْرًا فَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَهُ. And if you do more actions, recommended actions, other than the obligations, then it's better for you. وَأَنْ تَصُومُ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ إِنْ كُنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. And if you fast, it's better for you if you have knowledge. شَهْرُ رَمَضَانَ الَّذِي أُنزِلَ فِيهِ الْقُرْآنِ. شَهْرُ رَمَضَانَ. Ramadan is the month where the Quran was revealed. هدى للناس وبينات من الهدى والفرقان. Again, another objective. هدى, guidance. It is the month when the Quran was revealed so that you could achieve guidance. وبينات من الهدى والفرقان. And so that you achieve the clarity of guidance and a criteria between good and bad. Between right and wrong. وَبَيِّنَاتٍ مِّنَ الْهُدَى وَالْفُرْقَانِ فَمَنْ شَهِدَ مِنْكُمُ الشَّهْرَ فَلْيَصُمْهُ. And those who attend the month, they should fast. وَمَنْ كَانَ مِنْكُمْ مَرِيضًا أَوْ عَلَى سَفَرٍ. Again, and those who are sick or on travel, فَعِدَّةٌ مِّنْ أَيَّامٍ أُخَرٍ. يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ بِكُمُ الْيُسْرَ. Allah wants, Allah intends ease for you, yusr, facilitation for you. وَلَا يُرِيدُ بِكُمُ الْعُسْرِ. Allah does not intend, basically in English, to give you a hard time. Allah intends to give you ease. يُسْر. وَلَا يُرِيدُ بِكُمُ الْعُسْرِ. وَلِتُكْمِلُوا الْعِدَّةَ. And so that. See how many so that? All of these are objectives. And inshallah we go on them one by one. And so that you could complete, لِتُكْمِلُوا الْعِدَّةَ, you complete that number of days. وَلِتُكَبِّرُوا اللَّهَ عَلَى مَا هَدَاكُمْ. And so that you eventually do takbir, glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, perhaps the takbir of Eid, or just to glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. تُكَبِّرُوا اللَّهَ عَلَى مَا هَدَاكُمْ. You glorify Him as He guided you. وَلَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. And so that maybe, perhaps, you will thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then another verse, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ. And if my servants ask you about me, O Muhammad, say between brackets, he didn't even say. In the Arabic, he said, if they ask you about me, I am close. He didn't even tell him, say I am close, because it doesn't even take him to say, he is close. I am close, I am nearby. إِنِّي قَرِيبٌ. أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَانِ. And I answer those who pray to me if they pray. I mean, if they put the effort to pray, I will answer them. أجيبوا دعوة الداعي إذا دعان. وإذا سألك عبادي عني فإني قريب، أجيب دعوة الداعي إذا دعان فليستجيبوا لي. Let them answer my call. وليؤمنوا بي. Let them believe in me. لعلهم يرشدون. So that maybe, perhaps, they will be on the guided path. الرشد is the same like الهدى. But الرشد is maturity. Guidance with maturity. You know, so maybe لعلهم يرشدون. Maybe they will be on the guided path. And then other ahkam in Ramadan and so on. If we look at these objectives that the verses are clearly giving us, the objective of at-taqwa, that if you are going to pass through Ramadan and you don't achieve that objective, then as if you did not fast. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Man lam yanahu sawmuhu عن قول الزور والعمل به فليس لله حاجة في أن يضع طعامه وشرابه." If somebody is not going to stop saying lying, is not going to stop lying, and is not going to act in lying ways. الزور قول الزور والعمل بالزور. If you see when people sin, they are lying. They are lying to themselves. They are lying about their existence. Because who are you and where are you going? You are a human being who is here for a journey. And then you go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Those who sin and those who deviate are lying to themselves. And they are acting in line. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying, قول الزور والعمل به. It's not just شهادة الزور. It's not just witnessing in error in court or giving a false witness. These translations are very narrow. It's not just about false witness. It's about false witness of your existence, of your life, of where you're going and who are you and so forth. If you are not going to stop lying, the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to yourself or lying to people or acting in lying, then Allah doesn't need you to stop your food and drink. فليس لله حاجة في أن يضع طعامه وشرابه. It doesn't mean that if Allah forbids somebody lies, they go and break their fast. It doesn't mean that. But it means that the objective of fasting is to be true, is to be sincere. And fasting is a great school for that. Because when I fast, nobody knows that I'm fasting. This is the only ibadah that cannot have riya in it. You know, cannot have, I'm fasting for somebody else. Because if I'm fasting for somebody else, in a closed room, I'll eat and drink, you know, and then in front of people, I might as well. But you could pray and watching, people watching you praying or reading Quran. But when you fast, it's only for Allah, for sure. And that is a great lesson of sincerity, of ikhlas, of coming closer to Allah for subhanahu wa ta'ala, acquiring taqwa. And being true, there is no zur here, there is no lying here. You are very true to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when you fast. When you wake up in the morning, it's Fajr time, even if you're by yourself. You're going to put the water aside and the food and start fasting. And all the way until sunset. So this is being true. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ أَيَامًا مَعْدُودَاتٍ فَمَنْ كَانَ مِنْكُمْ مَرِيضًا أَوْ عَلَى سَفَرٍ. Those who are sick or on travel, those who have difficulty fasting, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala pardons them from that. فَعِدَّةٌ مِّنْ أَيَّامٍ أُخَرٍ. And then he says in the other verse, يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ بِكُمُ الْيُسْرَ. The objective here is facilitation and not difficulty. And every Ramadan we hear all of these fatawa that make people's lives difficult sometimes. I happen to be, you know, tested from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by answering these questions. And the questions sometimes, they don't make sense. You know, somebody has diabetes and heart attack and whatever, and they are sick. And they ask somebody for a fatwa and they tell them, no, you have to fast. And you have to continue fasting until, you know, what is that, 9 p.m. this year, subhanAllah. Until you die. And it reminds me of the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when the man had a wound and then he needed ghusl. So he asked his friends, do I have to do ghusl? They said, yes, you have to. You can't pray without ghusl. And he had this wound, so he had the ghusl and the wound open and he died. Prophet ﷺ said, قَتَلُوهُ قَتَلَهُمُ اللَّهُ. They killed him. May Allah kill them. Like a very strict dua here, that they killed the man by giving a fatwa that made the man die. Is ghusl about, you know, the people dying? It's about people being clean. But obviously life has a higher value. Sawm is about people having taqwa, people having sincerity in their heart, coming closer to Allah. And this is fine, but your life in the Sharia scale is a very important thing, your life. People lose their lives over some fatawa that are wrong, that make them fast even if they are going to die. Seriously. I witnessed some of these kinds of fatwas. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, it is not about difficulty, it is about facilitation. Is he making me fast and it is facilitation? Yes, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sometimes he tests us with things, with an end for the test to be good. So he is passing me through difficulty in life, or by being hungry and thirsty, or something that is a trial, ibtila from him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the bala is tamhis, is purification, tazkiyah. This is how it is. So he subhanahu wa ta'ala is making Ramadan a chance for ease. Why? Because I am, by fasting, a stronger person physically and a better person spiritually and a closer person to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a person who can stand longer in prayer. This is better. This is easier. This is more merciful for me. And he is giving me a temporary difficulty. The objective is a temporary difficulty, a temporary exercise. It's like taking somebody to a boot camp, as we say here in Canada. And then at the end of the boot camp, the guy is strong, he's a man. That is, the boot camp itself is tough, but the objective is ease. The objective is to be strong and therefore to be healthy. It's the same thing, but with our spirit, and inshallah with our bodies too. Doctors, alhamdulillah, year after year, they discover more and more benefits for fasting, more and more hikmah, wisdom. And this is also maqsood, this is also from the objectives that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala left open for us year after year to discover. With medicine and with research, we discover more and more how fasting is excellent for people's bodies. Even if your heart is missing, your body is a better and stronger body, a more able body. More and more people are fasting with Muslims these days, even though they are not Muslim. You go on the internet, you see some of these stories that, you know, from the benefits of fasting, I'm starting to fast. Now, one of the objectives that Allah mentioned, وَلَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. Ramadan has an objective so that we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In many ways, one of them, when I'm thirsty and hungry and start to eat and drink, I thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When I'm thirsty and hungry and I remember the poor and I remember people who are in refugee tents somewhere or in prison, Allah forbid, somewhere in injustice, of course, and or some people who are in a famine, many, many places in the world. The world is becoming a crazy place, as I started by saying. And so many famines and so many millions of refugees everywhere, mashallah, especially in the Muslim world, and so many tens of thousands of people who are deprived in many ways, subhanallah. And then you have a better chance to be shakur, to be a thankful person, when you feel the hunger and the thirst, and you feel tired because of one day of not having your coffee or having your lunch or whatever, then you realize that how spoiled you are. It's just over a cup of coffee, I'm feeling this headache. But people go for days without food because of, sometimes they don't even know because of what, you see, in this world, by the millions. And then you become thankful to who you are and what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving you. وَلَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. One of the objectives of Ramadan is when you are closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you ask Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if He subhanahu wa ta'ala allows you to ask Him, if He opens the door of remembering Him and asking Him, know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to give you something. Because He is Al-Kareem subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most generous. If one of us is known to be generous, if somebody ask them anything, they will give, you know, anything, even a little bit, even a smile. If you are a generous human being, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al-Kareem, the generous, the only generous, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if you extend your hands and ask Him, know that He is going to answer you. And He will answer you in two ways, either by giving you what you're asking for, or giving you better than what you're asking for. Nothing but those two things. Either what you are asking for, or not what you're asking for because it's not good for you, and He'll give you something better. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. But that is the reward of asking. وَلَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ. If they ask you, Muhammad, about me, tell them that I am close by, I am nearby. And you don't need to scream and so on. Like, by the way, like when we do the khatma and we start to pray, some people like, Ya Allah, and you don't need to call. The Prophet ﷺ saw a man doing that. He said, إِنَّكُمْ لَا تَدْعُونَ أَصَمًّا وَلَا غَائِبًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He told the man that Allah is not deaf and is not away. Allah is close. You just, you know, say Ameen, but you don't have to yell Ameen and cry, and Allah is there. Cry in the yelling sense, but of course crying is a great ibad. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking us to pray to Him, to remember to pray. Ujibu da'wat al-da'i, and then He says, إِذَا دَعَان, I will answer the call of those who call me upon me, if they call upon me, if they remember. You see, our problem is that sometimes we feel that we can do things and we don't remember to turn ourselves to Allah and ask. And if we ask, He will give us, as I said, like either what we ask for or something better. إِذَا دَعَان, if they ask me, I will give them. فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُوا لِي, let them answer me, let them answer my call. وَلْيُؤْمِنُوا بِي, let them not believe in me, increase in belief. Because iman increases by doing good things and by remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُوا لِي وَلْيُؤْمِنُوا بِي لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْشُدُونَ. And this is the ultimate goal from Ramadan, and this is the ultimate goal from the Quran. The ultimate goal is to be guided. You see, there are so many philosophies and so many ideas and so many roads that you could take, and so many, rahmakumullah, things. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to guide us. To guide us to what? To the straight path. Ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqim. A path from point A to point B that is straight. The shortest path, as we, where is the students here, geometry. The shortest point between point A and point B is a straight line. But sometimes we go in different curves and we get lost in this world. We get lost in the ideas and in the emotions and in so many things in this world. Allah wants to guide us on a straight path. From where to where? From where we are to Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Is He somewhere? No, subhanahu wa ta'ala is beyond space and time. But it's us who are going closer to Him by our hearts, by our consciousness, to have a higher consciousness that is closer to Allah. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as you know, doesn't have space and time, doesn't apply to Him. He created that. He created space and time to start with, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So yarshudun is to be on a straight path. And the whole Quran that is revealed in Ramadan that we are celebrating, why are we fasting? We're celebrating the revelation of the Quran. The whole Quran's objective, or number one objective, is huda. The second page, ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه هدى للمتقين. This is the book that is, no doubt about it, that is a guidance. Humanity is lost without a divine guidance. Humanity without a divine guidance is, at best, animals, you know, at best. And at worst, devils. And with guidance, humanity goes from devils to animals, and then from animals to better than angels, even, if they are guided. Humanity without guidance is very poor and in a miserable shape. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent this book to guide us. to a better life, better physically and morally and intellectually, legally, politically, the environment, the economics, the dealings, the prayers, anything you can think about. Islam is here to make it a better life. And humanity, without the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is totally lost. He sent Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with the Quran after in an era where humanity was totally lost. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as Muhammad said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the hadith, he looked at everybody on earth, فَمَقَتَهُمْ جَمِيعًا. All of them were in a horrible shape. They were in a hated shape. Except for a few, إِلَّا بَقِيَّةً مِنْ أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ. A few people kept on Deen Ibrahim, the Ibrahim's faith, very, very few. One here and one there, one in Arabia and one in Persia, you know, in the world. And the rest of the world was in total misguidance and total misery. They lived in palaces and so on, the Romans and the Persians, but they lacked their humanity and they lacked so many things. And you, when you read in history, you find that those Romans and Persians who lived in those big palaces, they committed suicide and they killed each other and they threw each other to the lions and all of that. I mean, they lived a life that is void of the most peaceful element and the most inner element of humanity. And he sent Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with that book to put humanity back on track. Believers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam have the full road to take, the full track, the full picture. And people, as much as they take from the Quran, as much as they are humans. You see, this society that we are praising is a good society because it's closer to these ideals. It's a society that gives charity, even for disbelievers. They give charity, they try to be clean, they try, not exactly in the best way, which is Muhammad's way, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The charity according to Muhammad is the best charity. Cleanliness according to Muhammad is the best cleanliness. Aqeedah, faith, according to Muhammad is the best faith. People could have other faiths and, you know, and so on, and give them some peace in their life and give them some motivation to give charity. But Muhammad والسلام, with this message is the best message and is the highest goal. And the closer humanity gets to that, the closer humanity is to guidance on the straight path. The path towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The path towards a life that is the real life. You see, when we die, we don't dream when we die. We are dreaming. We are in a half reality now. And when we die, it's the full reality. وَإِنَّ الدَّارَ الْأَخِرَةَ لَهِيَ الْحَيَوَانَ. Allah mentioned in the Quran that when we die, we have a real life. الحيوان أي الحياة الحقيقية, the real life when we die. So how are we going to get to meet our Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala if we are not going to be on the straight path? The Quran is putting us on the straight path. And one of the sunnahs that are very important in Ramadan is to read the Quran and to listen to the Quran and to give more attention to the Quran. And the Quran will shift everything about you, will shift your life to a better life through many, many things. The stories in the Quran will give you a role model and will take you through the story of Ibrahim. You learn from the model of Ibrahim so many things. How to say the truth in front of falsehood and how to leave the land of falsehood to a land of truth if the land of falsehood is going to persecute you. The story of Musa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a story of honesty and strength and also the word of truth and the worship and so forth. The story of Hud and Nuh and Muhammad, the stories have an objective, again a maqsid, to take you from point A to point B. By the end of the surah, you are a different person. With every surah, a surah focuses on the ahkam, on the rules, and another surah that focuses on the hereafter, on the al-qiyamah, and so forth, and a surah that focuses on the relationships between people and the family and so forth, a number of surahs, and a surah that takes you towards al-akhlaq, to be more merciful and more giving, and so on, Surah Noon or Surah Muhammad or salatu wasalam, and so forth. So the surahs, every surah, because of the ayat, takes you through a journey. And the journey, don't think it's random. The journey is designed very well. And every surah, the Prophet ﷺ ordered the verses in every surah. The verses were not put like that by the companions. He ﷺ sometimes has received something and he tells them, put it after this in Surah Al-Baqarah. And then the next thing, put it after this in Surah Al-Ma'idah. And then, so the order is meant to be and is intended. There is an objective from every surah and from every order. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about al-ahkam or the rules and then takes you to a story and then back to the rules and then back to the hereafter, and this is designed, and we could speak about that some other time inshallah, in the sense of the paragraphs in the surah is taking you in a journey. The end of the journey always is huda. ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ, guidance. So that by the end of Ramadan, when you read the Quran inshallah over and over, and when you reflect, you are guided, you are not lost in this world and all of its ideas and all of its emotions. You are guided and you are directed towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, towards pleasing Him, towards being a better person. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Ramadan brings these benefits to us. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be more guided after Ramadan than we are in the beginning of Ramadan. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to teach us and to give us this fiqh, this understanding. I'm mentioning fiqh since I'm expecting a few questions. There are two kinds of fiqh, my brothers and sisters. There is the fiqh al-jawarih, the understanding or the rules of the body. You know, what to do and, you know, when to start fasting and when to break and whether I can do that or I don't do that. And there is fiqh al-qalb, the rules of the heart. There is a fiqh, a whole fiqh, that we never ask about, even though it is more important, which is fiqh al-qalb. I receive questions on fiqh, and every 100 questions, there is one question about the heart. How can I be a better person? Even though fiqh al-qalb is the objective of Ramadan. And not fiqh al-jawarih, sometimes scholars differ, they have different opinions, different views, and most of the time they are all correct and they are all fine and subhanallah, nothing in particular. But it's fiqh al-qalb that is more important. We need to start to think about questions in terms of fiqh al-qalb. How can I be a better person? How can I concentrate in my prayers? How can I fast in a way that benefits my heart and benefits my iman, and so forth? These are the questions that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to be asked. The companions would go and tell him, how can I remember the hereafter? And the other one tells him, well, my heart is really hard. How can I soften my heart? These kinds of questions, fiqhi questions, are very important, but we don't ask them. We always ask questions, sometimes are irrelevant, to be honest. Sometimes, whether I smell bukhur or I don't, or I don't know. Like some questions I would decline to answer because they are not questions. They don't mean anything. Because if they mean something, we will find something in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, let alone in the Quran, talking about it. You know, but I mean, whether you smell perfume or not, I don't know. Maybe it doesn't contradict with, are you going to eat the bukhur? Or they say no. Okay, I don't know. I guess you can't help smelling things. Some people, especially bukhur, the bukhur question every Ramadan. And of course, the hilal question and all of that. So, jazakumullah khair, barakallahu feekum. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for this to be a reminder for myself and you for the importance of this month. And ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us, inshallah, through this month and bring us closer to the Quran, to His words, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Open our understanding to His words and our hearts to benefit from these words so that we are better people. We have taqwa and we have shukr and we have dhikr. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guidance and forgiveness. Jazakumullah khairan. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Jazakumullah khairan.
Now we have time for the question about the circle.
Jazakumullah khair.
I encourage
the policy to ask. Okay, brother. Inshallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. It's not about bukhur, huh?
Just
or the kind of bukhur.
The kind of bukhur, yeah.
Just a kind of inspiration from what you said. Uh-huh. You started with the verse that said, "Kutib alaykum al-siyam, kama kutib ala al-ladina min qablikum, la'allakum tattaqoon." And when you finish with fiqh al-qalb, that means for me fiqh al-hub, how to learn and how to be a faqih in doing hub to Allah, love to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to the creatures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then la'allakum tattaqoon, in my opinion, maybe I'm wrong, is not like what the long time ago they said, al-khawfu min al-jaleel wal-amalu bil-tanzeel wal-istidadu bil-yawm al-raheel, could be right, but at the same time, لعلكم تتقون في حق الله عز وجل لعلكم تحبون الله عز وجل وتفعلون ما يحبه الله سبحانه وتعالى والله. Because the taqwa for Allah سبحانه وتعالى is different from the taqwa النار. Taqwa النار be away of fire or hellfire. But taqwa الله عز وجل, it means for me how to love Allah سبحانه وتعالى and to do everything for the sake of loving Allah سبحانه وتعالى. And I will remember from Egypt what Rab'ah said very long time ago, and nowadays even, that, "Oh Allah, I love you, not because I'm afraid of the hellfire, or I am loving and like to be in paradise, but I worship you because I love you, because you deserve to be loved." This is the worshiping for loving, not for being as a slave, like the slaves for the other people, the kings or whatever. As much as you be slave to them, as much as they will give you what you want. No, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is different. That's why jazakumullah khairan for this kind of this feeling.
MashaAllah, this is a very, very Sufi reflection. Jazakallah khair. But they don't contradict, akhi. Yani the al-khawfu min al-jaleel wal-amalu bil-tanzeel. To apply the book, if this is the taqwa. In the book, in the tanzeel, وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبًّا لِلَّهِ قل إن كنتم تحبون الله فاتبعوني يحببكم الله. حب الله سبحانه وتعالى, the love of Allah سبحانه وتعالى is the application of the Quran too. The Quran is asking us to love Allah and love the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and in hadith. So they don't contradict or anything. العمل بالتنزيل or to apply the book as the definition of taqwa. That is a very big definition. But the book, you are right about that, the book is not only the rules. It's also the heart rules, not just the practical rules, but also the heart rules. And this is one of the rules of the heart, one of the fiqh al-qalb, a fard, really. In fact, the Prophet ﷺ, he said, you would not have perfect belief until you love me more than anybody else. In the hadith, حَتَّى أَكُونَ أَحَبَّ إِلَيْهِ مِنْ أَهْلِي وَلَدِيَ النَّاسِ أَجْمَعِينَ, until I am dearer to you than everybody and your children and everybody. Jazakallah khair. And in terms of worshipping Allah, not because of Jannah and Nar, I mean, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran said that the prophets who are at the highest rank, they worship Allah and they want Jannah and they want to escape from Nar. They don't contradict too. They love Allah, but they also want, you know, to live a good life. I mean, they in the afterlife anyway. So I think referring to the Quran is the thing that you know brings the perspective when it comes to tasawwuf and all of these beautiful meanings. Jazakallah khair. Jazakallah khair. Yeah, my brothers or sisters, yeah, inshallah. Jazakallah khair. Any question, any comment, correction, inshallah. Jazakallah khair. Naam, khair inshallah. If you don't ask me, I will start to ask you then, because who planned what to do in Ramadan? Like, you need to have a plan. So now let's get practical a little bit, not talking in the clouds. So did you have a table, what you're going to do in Ramadan, and need to plan, man. When we go on a trip for a week somewhere, we plan everything. We plan the hotel, we plan what to eat. And this is very important to plan. And to make a little table and try to fulfill the plan, to memorize something, to read something, to give charity, you know. And we are in a society that plans everything. Yes.
Instead of the doing the same thing every year, what other way or different way or to get me close to Allah Subhanahu wa Taala? I want to take a special road or a special way to in this Ramadan different from every year that I do. So what is your opinion, the best way to do
that? How to get close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Well, to get close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not far from you. وَنَحْنُ أَقْرَبُ إِلَيْهِ مِنْ حَبْلِ الْوَرِيدِ. We are closest to the human than their heart veins, their arteries. He is closer to us, but we are far because of a number of things that we don't do. To become close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is number one, al-dhikr, to remember Him. فَاذْكُرُونِي أَذْكُرْكُمْ. Remember, just remember Him. And you don't have to remember Him only by the tongue, subhanallah, 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 or alhamdulillah, or la ilaha illallah. To remember Him also by action, to do something for His sake, that is remembering Him. To go visit a relative that you've never visited, or call somebody in order to make them feel better, or give a kind of charity that you never gave, or you take an initiative. So something that is remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opens the doors of His mercy to you, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And subhanahu wa ta'ala sometimes doesn't make you feel it, so that you go further. Like you start to read the Quran and start to pray, Taraweeh and so on, and then after 5 days you don't feel anything. As if you're supposed to, you know, have a huge dream, or you wake up in the morning and you feel that, you know, the whole world is lit up. And like sometimes we think that by doing good things and going closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we have to have some miracle that happens, or a great feeling or something. You don't have to. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sometimes doesn't give you that so that you continue. Continue memorizing the Quran. Don't just stop at this surah. Continue the next surah. Continue to give that charity. That $1,000 that you gave is not the end of the road. See what else you can give. So that, and so forth. So, if you are on the right path and you are doing good and you are remembering Allah, know that you are getting closer to Him. Even if you don't feel it, if you don't feel those anwar and stuff, even if you don't feel anything, you are closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as long as you know that you are doing the right thing. Just by being here in the masjid, remembering Allah and deciding to do good things in Ramadan, we are getting closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whether we feel that we're becoming better people or not, we are. Because we are doing things, we are, you know. And if you find yourself in the wrong place, know that you are going further from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because if I am close to Allah, I wouldn't be in that bad place. Or I wouldn't be wasting my time doing whatever, other things. So the sign that you are closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is by doing better deeds. And He subhanahu wa ta'ala had made the good deeds so many, hundreds and thousands of things that we can do, so that each person knows him or herself. Somebody is better in giving charity. Somebody is better, I don't know, stronger physically. They could help people. Somebody needs to be patient because people around them are, you know, require patience, for example. Somebody could have a journey with the Quran. Somebody could, and so forth. Every person is different. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had opened so many doors of good. But as long as you are going through one of these doors, know that you are going closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And by the end of Ramadan, when you do this takbir and so on, know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had taken you closer. You reach the end of Ramadan and you're praying Eid. You know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving you the reward. And then every now and then, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will open your heart with a feeling that, you know, you feel that you are better, you are more, you are closer to Allah. You read the Quran and you feel more understanding, or you find yourself more tolerant, more generous, more forgiving, more patient. When you find yourself stronger in your iman, you know that you are taking the steps on the road. But the key here is to do good. And also, the key is not to feel proud. Sometimes we are self-righteous too much as Muslims. We feel that we have the truth, which is true, But then we feel that, oh, we are good, and are those people now, they don't pray and they don't do this, or I'm good. And we compare ourselves with people who are worse than us. But if we compare ourselves with people who are better or who do better things, then we perhaps will feel humble, and then we continue on the path. But our problem is that we compare ourselves with the losers always, and therefore we feel that we're not losers, and so forth, even though we could be losers, but we are comparing ourselves with a category of people that is really bad. So if we start to compare ourselves with people who are, to us, more, working harder, then perhaps we are on the right path. We are closer to Allah, coming closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Jazakallah khair. Yes.
Some ibadat we have for like Sharh al-Wujub and Sharh al-Siha, like Salat and Hajj.
Yeah, yeah.
What about the Ramadan, like fasting? Even the non-Muslims are prescribed. So I know they are not accepted unless they're Muslim.
Sharh al-Wujub. Oh, okay. So if a non-Muslim fasts.
Yeah.
It's not accepted. Who said, who accepts it? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Well, it's up to him. I don't know.
No, when you go to Sharh al-Siha, if they are not Muslim and they fasting or praying, it's not accepted.
Why? Maybe Allah will accept it. I don't know. I don't look in their hearts. What do you mean? If somebody fasts and they are not
Muslim,
okay?
Is it the shirt, like they have to be Muslim to be accepted?
For sure? I don't know. Acceptance is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And therefore, I don't know their hearts. If one of them comes and asks you, ask him or her, do you believe in God? Like they do this for him? I mean, I had this experience before. Like somebody fasted with Muslims, she said, in Eva. And she said, well, I decided, an old lady, but she decided to fast. Jazakallah khair. So, can I fast? Can I pray like Muslims and fast for this Ramadan? I said, why not? Like, do you believe in God? She said, yeah, why am I praying or fasting? I said, okay, but for me, you're Muslim. She said, no, I'm not. Said, okay. I left it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to judge. You know, if they are fasting only for the nutritional exercise, like if in their hearts they are fasting because a doctor told them that this 9 to 9 is really good, or Fajr to dawn, and they are doing it in their heart just for exercise. Well, they are like anybody who exercises, you know, it's just, but it's in the heart. I can't judge. What I'm saying is that we know that to save yourself in the afterlife is to believe in Allah. But who believes and who doesn't, and who is on the path, we don't know. So what we should do as Muslims is to welcome people when they take a step, even if it's just a practical step. Not, they didn't say shahada, but they decide to pray with you tonight. Like we often, I don't know if you have it here, in different masjids in Ottawa as well, like sometimes people come to the masjid, can I pray with you today? Yeah, well, welcome, no problem. And they pray. Are you Muslim? They say no. But subhanAllah, but yeah, we're going to tell them, no, go away. You have to be Muslim before you pray. Shart al-Sahha, the philosophy of the fuqaha. No, I don't want to apply their philosophy on them. I want them to take a step. You see, the usul here, what, Zakallah khair, you're talking about usul al-fiqh, doesn't apply to this. What applies is mercy, you know, just, you know, pray, yeah, fast. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide them. If after the exercise they decide that, well, it's good for my body, but I'm not going to believe in God, khalas, then it's their issue. But inshallah, we should encourage that.
That might open the gate for them to ask more questions.
Absolutely, subhanAllah.
Yeah, so yeah. We should not stop them. Come and...
Of course.
Little by little, they might, inshallah, be
Islam. Wallahi, akhi, I had so many experiences with people who embraced Islam after experiences like these. Like a brother once told me, he said, I came to pray in the masjid. I didn't feel anything and so forth. And I thought, well, They read the long reading, I didn't understand. And then they bowed, I didn't understand. And then when they made sujood, he told me, I felt very different. So by the time he made sujood, he felt, well, this is nonsense, I'm going to go, I'll never come back. But when he made sujood, he said, when I put my face on the ground and I felt that I'm bowing to God, he said, I felt very different. And I felt that Islam is combining the physical with the spiritual, he told me. By making people express their guidance or their prostration physically, but somehow I felt very spiritual in that. And I didn't want to go up. I see that everybody's going up. He wanted to continue with the sujood. So here is an experience of somebody that wanted, you know, to try. And Allah guided him in the sujood. He became Muslim after. He didn't want to go up from the sujood because he felt so good. We know from Islam, the Quran is saying that when you make sujood, you become closer to Allah. Not closer physically, as we mentioned, but so he had he met somebody at the door, brother, because I don't know, he's white or whatever, okay, who are you? Are you Muslim? No, go. He wouldn't have known Islam. But we need to ask people, as long as they respect the masjid. I'm not saying that, you know, they do something in the masjid or eat something haram or wear something haram or any of that. But as long as there is a minimum amount of respect to the place and we guide them gently. Subhanallah, Allah guides people through that sometimes.
Whether it's accepted or not accepted, as from song or salat, describe it, even the non-Muslims or only Muslims?
Well, it is for everybody. The Quran is not only for Muslims. The Quran is for humanity. يا أيها الذين آمنوا كتب عليكم الصيام كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم. Oh, you believe, Allah prescribed fasting you as it was prescribed for those who were before you. So if he or she is Christian or whatever, they are supposed to fast too, and Ramadan, and 30 days, and from dawn to sunset. And that is how Isa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fasted, and Musa, and everybody. But they found it difficult, so they started to introduce what we call in the Sharia bid'ah. So what happened, if you read in history, they started like that, in the right history, of course. They have a number of tracks when it goes to Christian history or the Jewish history. But somewhere in the readings, you will find a fasting and prayer, in fact. Ruku' sujood, exactly like us. But then they found it too difficult. So they start to fast from food, but drink. You know, so they say, well, it's too much food and drink. We just drink and we're not going to eat. And then eventually they developed another bid'ah, which is what they apply today in some churches, which is to choose a kind of food or a kind of drink that they don't want to. So for example, they go for the whole month without chocolate, for example. That is fasting now. And I have seen people in this country from certain churches who do that. But they don't fast Ramadan anymore. I think the lunar months mixed with the solar months at some point in this bid'ah history. And then now they fast in other seasons. But it used to be Ramadan and it used to be exactly like us. So if they go back to part of their Sharia, we accept it. Well, okay, yeah, well, we believe in that. This is why we... I was just reading the other day in a Bible, or a Gospel rather, that they found in some of the caves and whatever. And the Gospel is talking about Jesus praying. And then they said, no, the Gospel is very old, but this is not authentic. Why? The researchers are saying because it described a prayer that is very similar to the Muslim prayer. But the Muslim prayer came after in history, so this must be unauthentic. Well, to solve this historical question is, well, it is the Muslim prayer that is similar to Jesus' prayer. Not that Jesus had prayed like Muslims, therefore this is not Jesus, you see. But they found, so every now and then, they find more and more evidence that their Sharia was originally very close to ours. Of course, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had made things that are lawful that were forbidden. وَوَضَعَ عَنْهُمْ إِسْرَهُمْ وَالْأَغْلَالَ الَّتِي كَانَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ Allah had put more obligations on the people before us out of punishment. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran is saying that he didn't allow the Jews, for example, وَعَلَّذِينَ هَادُوا حَرَّمْنَا كُلَّذِي ظُفُرْ He didn't allow them to eat anything that has nails.
ومن البقر والغنم حرمنا عليهم شحومهما. From the lamb and the cows, we forbade them to eat the fat. So fat was haram for them. Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, amongst other things, came to change that, because it is the Sharia of mercy. What's haram is only, you know, pork and alcohol and intoxicants and anything that is slaughtered other than Allah for any deity and so forth. But their Sharia is originally ours. And when we find the document that Jesus was praying exactly like Muslims, that's what the Quran is saying. You see? Yes.
Since we're on the topic, I have two questions.
Further.
Number one, can a non-Muslim enter the masjid without performing wudu and pray?
Mm-hmm.
That's my first question. And second, can we give zakat to non-Muslims?
طيب, the non-Muslim entering the masjid without wudu. Yes, they don't do wudu because they are non-Muslims. Yes, they can. My evidence is not my whims. My evidence is that they did that at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In a number of ahadith, Bani Najjar, I remember one ahadith, they were, what were they, Sheikh? Well, Christians. They were Christians, and they came to ask about Islam, and they went in the masjid, and they had this meeting. So in the sunnah, this is there. I don't care what somebody after the sunnah says. Once there is a sunnah, you see, it's like exactly, my sisters are here in the masjid. And the Prophet ﷺ said, لا تمنعوا إماء الله مساجد الله. Do not prevent women from the mosques. Some people after the time of the Prophet prevented women from the mosques. I don't care about that. I have the sunnah. Is the sunnah sahiha? Yes, Bukhari and Muslim and everything. Okay, khalas. So for non-Muslims to enter the masjid, yes, they enter. If they start to ask about Islam, then we tell them, as the Prophet did, ﷺ, he is our example. To take a shower, to do wudu. If they tell you, I want to pray, do you do something before you pray? Yeah, well, yeah, we purify. How? We try to simplify for them. Can we give zakat to non-Muslims? Yes. And I know that there are other opinions that say no. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِنَّمَا الصَّدَقَاتُ لِلْفُقَرَاءِ وَالْمَسَاكِينَ وَالْعَامِلِينَ عَلَيْهَا. He didn't say لِلْفُقَرَاءِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ وَالْمَسَاكِينَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ وَالْعَامِلِينَ عَلَيْهَا. He didn't say that. But even for those scholars who said that the faqir and the miskeen, the poor and the needy has to be Muslim, when they went to the item that's called وَفِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ and the item that's called وَالْمُؤَلَّفَةِ قُلُوبُهُمْ, those that you reconcile their hearts with you by giving them from the zakah, and فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ, for the way of Allah. In these two particular chapters, no scholar said it's not, because by definition, those you reconcile their hearts are not Muslim. You're giving them from the zakat. And fi sabilillah, many of the scholars, and I would venture to say most, if you want to refer to the past, most of the scholars said that fi sabilillah includes Muslim and non-Muslim, and includes giving and receiving, so somebody receiving, and includes giving without receiving, which means to give the organization. So fi sabilillah is to give to a charity that makes those tents for the refugees. You're not giving the refugee in his hand, but you give the charity. So fi sabilillah is much more flexible when it comes even to the traditional opinions. But if you ask about my humble opinion, no, there is no restrictions there. There is. It's not about Muslims or non-Muslims.
Just
a
sister's question.
Yes, please. Yeah.
Why sister's no question?
No questions. I'm glad they agree with everything then. I'm glad. Alhamdulillah. MashaAllah. Feel free, sisters, to ask questions, please, or give comments or add anything. Please.
Also, I will say again, based on what I heard right now, isn't one of the maqasid al-sharia, maqasid al-siyam, or breakfasting objectives, isn't the feeling that we call it toward a global civilization of love and tolerance,
yeah,
even with non-Muslims, because this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala orders us to do. And believe me, when I read one of the titles like this in front of my son, Mansour, he said global is wrong. I don't know why. He said because he should say towards a universal Because globe means earth, but universe means everything.
He's a philosopher, mashallah. He's differentiating between global and universal. Allahu Akbar. Like, okay, well, he has to study philosophy then. Because that is something.
That's why, believe me, we need this feeling, especially we're here in this kind of community. And I remember, I swear to Allah, one of the verses that saying, Allahumma la taj'alna or hadith, Allahumma la taj'alna fitnatan lilladhina kafaru.
It's not a hadith, it's an ayah. Rabbana la taj'alna fitnatan lilladhina kafaru wa afir lana rabbana.
Subhanallah, I understood it like, oh Allah, do not make us bad examples in representing Islam, and the non-Muslims see us, they said, thank God because we are not Muslims.
Wallahi jazakallah khair. This is a very important reminder, mentioning masjids and how we behave in Ramadan. When people get more interested in Islam because of Ramadan and all of the talk, لا تجعلنا فتنة, do not make us a test for others. Sometimes with our behavior, we put others in a very awkward position when it comes to Islam. And I heard this from more than one person in the society. I went to the mosque, I wanted to ask about Islam, but people didn't like me to be there or didn't welcome me. And that is a fitna, because they turn and they never come back.
About the zakat on Muslims, is that okay?
Yes, as long as they're fuqara and masakeen and so forth. People who are poor and needy. And in fact, some of the scholars, if you're asking about the history of fiqh, يعني, some of the scholars differentiated between the faqir and the miskeen. And they say that the faqir is Muslim and the miskeen is non-Muslim. Or there are many opinions, but if you want a short answer, yes. You can give your zakat to somebody who is poor or needy or in debt, who is a Muslim.
But you know this person is always in this corner, you know what I mean? And then sometimes you just give them a spare change.
Yeah, why not?
You know you're encouraging them to, like...
Yeah, that's very important.
Because some of them are alcoholics.
Yeah, this is your judgment then. This is your judgment.
Some of them are alcoholics.
And drugs and all these.
This is your judgment. I had this, I don't remember where, a couple of weeks ago, and I remember somebody asked me, man, you have change. What was that again? And I felt that the person is an addict and not in a good shape, and I wasn't sure. So I tried to have a conversation with the person. Usually, like, to be honest, usually I try to, you know, be a step away just in case they are dangerous or whatever. But I thought, well, so I told him, I want to give you the change, but I want you to be good. Like, what are you gonna do with it? He said, I want to buy food. And so I said, okay, how about I buy you food? He said, okay. So I was in front of some grocery store. I went in, got him a sandwich. I said, okay, here is food. He said, okay. So an example. Another example where, okay, you promise that you're not going to do anything bad with this money. I promise. Maybe they will not take the promise, but it's up to your judgment. You don't have to, you know. You don't have to give, because giving is an optional deed. Rasul ﷺ said, خَيْرٌ مِنْ أَيَسْأَلِ النَّاسِ مَنَعُوهُ أَوْ أَعْطُوهُ. The Prophet ﷺ told the man, you ask people, they will give you or they will not give you. So it's really optional. Even though, of course, it's the Islamic behavior is to give. وَأَمَّا السَّائِلَ فَلَا تَنْهَرْ. Do not push away somebody who asks you. But at least if you don't give money, give a good word. Give, say, I'm sorry, or something, and go. Yeah. Inshallah. Jazakumullah khair. Jazakumullah khair. Doctor.
The brother.
Oh, yes, please.
Just told me about a story. He says that the former mayor of Toronto went to one of the masjids and no one welcomed him, so he left away.
You see, yeah, so here's the former mayor of Toronto. Yeah. Nobody is welcoming him.
Yeah.
So we would have had a Muslim mayor. We would have made news like the London mayor. Now, subhanAllah, the masjid, وَأَنَّ الْمَسَاجِدَ اللَّهِ فَلَا تَدْعُوا مَعَ اللَّهِ أَحَدًا. Masjid, as in Surah Al-Jinn, is the place where Tawheed exists. You know, that's, we can pray anywhere. The Prophet ﷺ said, جُعْلَتْ لِيَ الْأَرْضُ مَسْجِدًا وَطَهُورًا. We can pray anywhere. Everywhere is a masjid in Islam. But why a specific point? So that it's a place for those who want to ask. This is the real purpose. But the purpose to pray, we can pray anywhere. Everywhere is allowed. Except for the dirty places and all of that, you know. But so the place, the masjid is a place for tawheed. And I think we have to open up, given Ramadan, to the wider society. And perhaps, Dr. Wael, perhaps have an open day I like the idea of open days. I've seen it in other countries. I lived in the UK for some time. We have it here as well. So an open day for Ramadan. Everybody's interested in Ramadan. So we have an open day. And Jamia Mosque.